actually do have a successful clothing design business in your career. To marry an American man, you convinced her to marry him and then came to America with him. Not long after they went to this country, not long after they were married, she discovered that he was already involved with other women, stepping on the right. He wanted to divorce her. He wanted to get rid of her. He tried to pay her money to go away. And she refused. And I met them because they landed in the church where we were, and we were being children at the time. And I got to know them so particularly. She was a preacher, a preacher's kid, pastor's kid. And as some of them will do, early on as a teenager, she had rebelled against church and against God and turned away, rebelled against her father. And then her father hadn't wanted her to marry a Western American. And so now she suffered. That her husband was actually God's punishment for her. And then that seemed like maybe it was. And so she decided she would become his punishment because he deserved it. And it was only fair. And they were in a relationship, might as well make the worst of it, I guess. Coming back to her faith and coming back to church, it's really most interesting. Perspective on things, and an interesting faith that was expressed in unique ways, I guess, in nature. And for instance, she thought that I had healing power. So she would, some families come out of church, and I would hold out my hand to shake hands with her, and she'd take my hand and smack it on her own forehead and hold it there, and then she'd go there and she'd say, "All better, man. Okay," and then she would get it. And apparently it worked because she kept doing that over time and it seemed to benefit her somehow. Anyway, she came to mind as week. She's never far away. She came to mind this week as we're walking Jesus off the boat. His last week, the reading was across over the other side of the Sea of Galilee, where one of the Gentiles found out of the sea, and there was a storm. And there wasn't a bridge over trouble there, there was a storm. Well, this week he's back on this side, crossing over the east, back where he belongs. And the crowd that had been gathering before he left is the storm. And so now, as he's moving along beside the sea, he's also sort of pillared in the sea of humanity. It's like the sea fell, I think, or something like that. This is mass moving with him. And it's in this mass of people that he meets this leader of the local synagogue. He begs his help because his daughter is very ill. And notice that the synagogue leader, the religious official, falls at Jesus' feet to beg him to cure him. Now, this is not usually the way that religious officials engage Jesus. So it tells us something, right? It tells us that he's desperate, perhaps. Maybe that he actually believes Jesus has some power to do what he wants him to do. Maybe he's heard of him, seen him in action. Maybe he just wanted an action to do this for himself. An important story, right? And he's in prayer. So he begs Jesus to come with him. Jesus consents, and away they go. And this is then where we get the story within the story. Mark likes to do it. He likes to tuck stories inside of stories, like stories moments. And as they're moving along, in the sea of humanity, there's this woman who shouldn't be there. This woman who has been bleeding for a long time. Most likely, it's not spotted, but most likely it's a mental issue. But this won't stop. And she's been to doctors to try not to get cured, and she's spent whatever money she had covering that month. And she hasn't gotten cured, and she's gotten worse. It's a history of it. So, if all these things happen with her, it's not bad. Because of this bleeding, she's literally unclean, impure. So she can't participate in the activities of the community. She's got to start out on the edge. he is poor, you lend money, whatever money for him is spent. It suggests that maybe there's no money coming in, and there's people money for you that do the sort of income in that culture. And she's probably either never married or divorced, perhaps because of the bleeding, and she couldn't have children because of the bleeding. And she's not supposed to be in this family because whoever she touches is defiled. So she's breaking the rules of the law. And her family probably has pushed her out because of the stigma of having someone like that close to you. They wouldn't even be able to hear her. And so, this woman is cursed, truly cursed. She is as good as dead. But, the scene that crossed through my mind this week, and I apologize up front, there was some money passing where the man was being hauled out, going to pray, going out with God, and the woman is hauling out the old man, and the old man says, I'm not dead yet. She's not dead yet. And she knows of Jesus. She's heard of him. She knows that he is able to do it. And he's within weeks. She's already this is not supposed to be. So watch one more thing. One night, reach out and touch the guy. And so she does. She's got nothing to lose. And immediately, and that's one of Mark's favorite words, and immediately she realizes something has happened. There's a change in her, she can feel it. And immediately Jesus realizes something has happened because there's a change in him. And then he's just sort of, and I think there's a return to him. And he's spinning around trying to figure out, who touched me? Who was it? He's asking his disciples, who are sort of his entourage. Yeah, it's like it, there's no room between you and anyone else. He wasn't touching you, he isn't touching you. Come on. Get real. She is the only one of all those who are banging into him, rubbing up against him. She is the only one that has access to power, the spirit, the energy that he carries but does not contain. The life, the power, the spirit of Jesus, the God flowing through him, flows out of him into her just like the blood is flowing out of her. And while she is bleeding to death, she is living others into life, living in a way that gives grace to all of those who seek it, who need it. And Jesus wants to know. Who is it that's talking to them? Of all these people who can have access, who is it that can have access? Because who can have access to them? But someone that she does. And at the end of it, he commends her for her faith, which he never does with his disciples. They never do it. She does. And so she, in fear, steps out and what's the waiting that might give her? She tells the whole truth. Isn't it interesting language? She tells the whole truth. She gives her testimony. She tells him her story. She tells him her brother here, all that's going on. And by standing there, he just takes it all in. He listens to her. And then he celebrates with her whole resurrection because that's what this is. This is, she has been raised from the dead. It's exactly what's going on. It's a resurrection story. And she says, Daddy, your faith is needed. You didn't need to go to the temple. You didn't need to follow the rules. You didn't need to make a sacrifice. Do you want to get back? He says, in my head, he says that. Do you see what's going on here? It's not about that stuff. It's not about sacrifices and following rules and going here, pilgrimages. It's about this faith, this deep, language connection you have with God. There's other things facilitated, but they can't take the place of it. But I think you're getting something, Jesus. And there's the story within the story. He said the story, and now the word comes that the little girl that ran over to here has died. Don't bother, they say. You have the Bible. and Jesus looks at the leadership of the father of the leader and says to her, again in my head, says to her, did you see what just happened here? Did you see this? Okay, we're going to take their word in mind. We're going to go with them or with me. And the reason why the leader is a resurrection story is that it's an obvious thing. There are some interesting parallels, some details in which he stories. The little girl is healed. So, how long was the woman suffering with this thing? 12 years. The disciples, when Jesus asked, who is it that has access to power that I bring you? They laugh at him. This is still his question. Maybe it's a time of his being, but they laugh. The moment is when Jesus comes towards the little girl and says, who does this take away? This is stupid. They laugh at him. They mock him. And there are some rules that are transgressed. The woman who is bleeding and reaches out and touches Jesus, which defiles him. He doesn't care because the defilement becomes the vehicle for holding life. He goes into the room of this little girl who's dead and touches her, touching the dead body, defiles her. He doesn't care. That becomes her way of raising up. The correction becomes new. That is when it lives again, lives anew. It's about the kind of faith here that he's doing. There is also a political angle on this story that Mark has kept in here. How many tribes comprise the nation of Israel? So, just the first set of disciples representing the 12 tribes. Is Mark perhaps saying in about the year 70 as Jerusalem is being to get some people being turned down, that it's Israel that is sick to death, that it's Israel that's bleeding to death, it's Israel that's being bled to death by the Romans and the collaborators. And so, Jesus brings the power of God into the very midst to transform, to raise them up. So, what is it that's stopping you? What's holding you back from joining, from embracing this movement? Is it the rules? Is it the law? Is it the temple? Is it the purity code that keeps you fractured and separated and suspicious of each other and weak? The way it's connected. Do you not see it? The kingdom of God is coming. That's the thing. Simply as husbands, the one who has got the mind on the heart, the one who is, and the one who is. We can all do that. And then it means the people I've talked to and the wives who had a malignant brain tumor. It slowly took us up. And see, the only thought, this is God too. But while he was dying, he became almost deathly ill himself and has to go through a major constant exposure if he has to have, which is long recovery. And during that recovery time, he tells us that years before, when they had crossed over and were visiting his family, the husband had molested her niece. The niece had the same thing. She kept it a secret because she was ashamed and she was afraid. And not that long before marriage, he had revealed that secret and the sins that would result. She didn't finally cut her off or without talking to her. There was nothing to do with her. There was no communication around her. She couldn't talk with her grandchildren because she didn't know where anybody was. And the family was in turmoil. And so she became her own version of the woman in the story. She was dead to her family. Her husband was dead and gone by this time. She was an old house. She was poor because he left her. And poverty is not there. So what could she hope for? She was a story today. What sort of restoration could she pray for? What sort of resurrection could come to her? What would it look like? Would it perhaps look like a community, of what's going to affect people. And in that statement, it says that not only is he poor, but embraced her and loved her and supported her and surrounded her and marveled at her resilience, but still hurts. Would it look perhaps like a group of friends who were all over one another and all over the country, but who supported her and loved her and stood by her and reached out to her through all of them, never deserving her? Would it look like perhaps this deep, unusual faith that she had, this everyday connection with God that was constant, that she lived out in most interesting ways? She made chocolate chip cookies for people who were not well, because she believed chocolate had healing properties. And she would make these cookies that were big and they were lifted out and crispy, and when she pressed them out on the pan, she prayed for them. They were going to. I was a recipient many times of her cookies. She brought buckets of Kentucky Fried Chicken to the classroom because there was this young Korean boy, this teenage Korean boy, who needed the nourishment. And she loved him. Her son. And I told you about what she believed I could do. One Sunday, she goes out of church and she says, "You pray for me and make them sleep." And she had all this guilt and all this pain and all this grief that she was carrying. And so, she asked the priest, the next Sunday, going out of church, she says very loudly, "You may pray for me anymore. I must stay awake to hear the fortune." And then she laughed. She stood up and everybody laughed at her. And then, we all laughed at her. The shortly after that, she went to a concert. And she was only about 62, 63. But she said it was enough. It was time to go home. It was time to close down. It was time to close down. So she put whatever she had in order and she gave away everything that she had and said it was going to somebody who could use it. And then she said, "I need it." And she looked at me and I was expected to do something to send her out. She expected me to offer her out of this world. I said, "I didn't do that. I don't have that ability and I don't have that right. Even if I do." And she got angry at that. And me, but she let that go. And I think about it. All kinds of people come from all over the place. People we didn't know. People who are connected with her. People whose lives she touched and found and enriched. And they kind of witness to her and the kind of stories about her. It was amazing. And then the church itself. At least that has lived in faith of its own time and generosity and goodness and grace and peace. It opens hearts. It crosses barriers. It rearranges things. And it becomes its own resurrection. The woman who touched Jesus' robe, seeking healing and infirmed his feet. The man who fell at Jesus' feet, begging for his help for his daughter. They desperately needed the power of God, and they sought it and accessed it in this moment. Right there, in the and did the same thing in her own way, every day, every day, every day. It was her story. It is her story. It is our story as well. It is our mind. It is potential.